Now, what do moonstarers do, and why might they call themselves that?
Well, the clue would appear to be in the question.
It's too obvious. I'd say they watch bare arses all the time.
Yeah. Moonstarers is an anagram of astronomers.
Yay! Oh. Points to you.
Good work.
That is damn fast.
It's not an anagram, it's an aptogram. Sorry.
I'll never win the Sandy Tabs, will I?
What's an aptogram, Sandy?
An aptogram is an anagram that where the word means roughly the same.
Like Apple Macintosh and laptop machines.
Yeah. Semolina is no meal.
Yeah.
Yes, Moonstarer is an anagram of astronomer. In what time in history was that a relevant thing, the idea of anagrams and astronomers?
Well, it must have been around the time of Galileo, surely.
It was indeed, the early 17th century.
But he wouldn't have spoken English, so why would he have changed his name to Moonstarer?
This is an example of an anagram. He, he didn't use English anagrams, he used...
Latin.
Latin. There he is. Why would they have used Ars Magna, great art?
Oh, and that's moon as the arse.
And Ars Magna and is an anagram of anagrams. So, yeah.
But anyway, because the church took a dim view of
Not because of the church, although the church did take a dim view of what he did. And
I like his very casual approach to the telescope. He's just sort of casual. Now I'm going to have a cigarette and now I'm going to look again.
Was it just to make the whole thing more fun?
If only it was that. In fact, even in his day, there was scientific rivalry. So if you discovered something and you wanted to tell a friend about it, you didn't want anyone else to intercept the news, you gave it in anagram form.
It's like codes at school.
Yes, it is exactly that.
Do you think they ever used to, like, rub around the telescope with ink and then run away and they'd be like, oh, what's that? Oh, no, my eye!
Who was his triggering great rival and friend?
Is it an anagram? Copernicus.
No, it wasn't Copernicus, it was Kepler. And he sent him an anagram because he'd discovered the rings of Saturn in 1610.
Yeah. No, not Saturn, that's Uranus.
Sorry, I'm laughing at the wrong one.
It's still the
I think one of them was funny. And he sent Kepler this.
Oh, my.
Ah, Smythe's Merlin mother.
Yes.
No guitarist.
Stick that way, the sun don't
it's
shine.
It's pretty obvious what he's putting there.
Yep.
It's a Latin phrase. It actually is an anagram.
I've discovered the rings of Saturn.
Yes, it is that. Altissimum planetam tergiminum observavi.
Okay.
I've observed the highest planet to be triplets.
Does he mean he's seen the moons of it or something? What does he mean by
triplets? Well, he thought they were moons, but in fact, we now know them to be rings.
That must have been so exciting. Do you not think? It must have been so thrilling. Just that one moment when that suddenly has happened and nobody else has seen it.
I think it's quite clever. I didn't even thought about it, but they worked out their planets because they were moving across the sky and the stars weren't. That's just the first thing that made them think.
Oh, I know.
Something was afoot.
And that's what...
That one's moved. Yeah. Why is that star moved? It's not a star, it's Jupiter.
Yeah. And planet is from the Greek for wanderer. It means a wanderer.
They do this thing in... I don't know if they're still doing it, but they did it for a long time. Once a month in Reykjavik, the government would turn out all the street lighting and there would be a lecture on the public radio about the stars. People would go outside and they'd got rid of all the ambient light and you could look up and listen to the public lecture about what you were looking at. Do you not think that would be
wonderful? That is brilliant. Yeah.
Thank you for watching. Do remember to subscribe to the QI channel and click here to watch more videos.